Hello, I'm Angela Starrett. This Halloween, let's skip the tricks and share some treats. This is Our Vancouver. Coming up, uncover the hidden history of our city with a brilliant new book. And discover why good seeds are key to growing massive pumpkins. But first, after you've finished your sweet Halloween treats, we've got suggestions for what you should eat next. Well, let's face it, candy is to Halloween what turkey is to Thanksgiving. It's the traditional food we get to indulge in when it's that time of year. But when the sweets are gone, how do we get our health back on track? Well, our guest, Kelsey Moore, has some advice. She's a registered dietitian who works for Choices Markets. Hello.
Hi, Angela. Thanks for having me.
Thanks for joining us. I mean, first of all, why do you think we love sweets so much at Halloween? Why do we love those Halloween treats?
Yeah, that's a good question. It's no secret that we all crave Halloween treats. We all crave candy. And tonight is definitely a time for some indulgence. And, you know, I think it's really important considering the times that we're going through right now that we do actually take the opportunity to enjoy Halloween, enjoy some treats tonight, and then we can get back on track tomorrow, back to our healthy, balanced eating.
There's so much controversy around sugar, but I guess the biggest one for parents at Halloween is our teeth. It could do a lot of harm to our teeth. Aside from that, though, what other harms can candy cause to our body and to our health?
Yeah, so sugar does actually play a big role in our immune system. So particularly if we're eating a lot of refined products over time, it can disturb the gut microbiome. So it's definitely something that we want to try and limit, but again, still enjoy during those times of celebration.
Mm-hmm. And once we get to the bottom of our Halloween sacks, the bottom of the bowl, we might not feel so good. You know, we often hear about children eating all their candies in one night and then getting a stomach ache. What's going on with that type of scenario?
Yeah, for sure. So so something that we can do to maybe help avoid a little bit of that is if we're making sure that our children are getting a well-balanced dinner before we have our Halloween treat, that might help with some of that stomach upset and might help them fall asleep a little bit easier.
And I understand you have a sample dish to share with us today. What have you got for us?
Yes. Okay. So I have this beautiful poke bowl that I made here.
Wow. That's lovely.
Yeah, it's delicious. I've tried it myself already. I made this poke bowl in mind with the winter season coming up and immune function is really important right now. So what I have here in the bowl is I have a number of ingredients that can help support our immune system, like some protein from the smoked salmon and the edamame beans, as well as a number of different nutrients in the bowl I can talk about as well.
Yeah, so tell me what you've got there. What am I, because you said smoked salmon, what else are we looking at?
Yeah, so what I have here, I have all the ingredients laid out. We have some fresh mango in the bowl. We have some shredded carrot. We've got some chopped red onion. I think some pickled red onion would go nice in there too. We've got some cucumber, some healthy fats, and some fiber from our avocado, some purple kale, which is just finishing off the end of its season right now, and then some edamame and black sesame seeds.
And so I've actually never had a poke bowl. I've heard lots about them, but what is the idea to just eat it like that, or do you put salad dressing on it? Do you just stick a fork in it? It looks
beautiful.
Yeah,
well, I definitely, thank you. I definitely encourage you to try it. So traditionally, I know when you go out and purchase one, usually they'll have some raw fish in there, and I've chosen smoked salmon in particular. But yeah, typically it contains like a base of rice, then maybe some kale or some sort of greens. And then we've got a few different vegetables. I like to throw something sweet in, like the mangoes or pineapple. And then we have a dressing that goes on top. I know traditionally sometimes some spicy mayo is good in there. I chose an avocado garlic dip for this bowl. And then you just mix it all together and eat it with a fork. And it's really simple and easy, something you can grab on the go or take to work.
So we were talking earlier about having a balanced meal to sort of balance out all that sugar. And I just wanted to follow up on, because I'd asked you about what's happening when you have the stomachache. Can you expand on that a little bit? Because I'm really curious about that. Why do we get a stomachache after we eat a whole bunch of candy?
Yeah, it could be a number of things going on there. But I think one of the key things is probably the overeating. In general, with Halloween treats, it's really easy to want to indulge and eat just a lot of food at once. So when we're looking at our three main macronutrients, so protein, fat, and carbohydrates, sugar is a refined version of carbohydrates. But things like protein are going to be more satiating and more filling, so we can eat a smaller amount of something like protein, and it'll fill us up more quickly. Whereas the sugar, it's easy to eat a lot of and then not feel full, and then it can hit us later, and we can get a stomachache.
Thank you so much for your time today. I really appreciate this.
Yes, thank you so much for having me. And if anybody's interested in learning more about nutrition, they can come and check out our webpage at choicesmarket.com. And then we also have our registered dietitians and nutritionists in store for people to come and chat to as well.
Thank you so much, Kelsey.
Perfect. Thank you.
And I hope you have a happy Halloween.
Yes, you too. Thanks.
Hi, I'm Nasheer.
I'm Freda.
This is our Vancouver.
Well, it's time for one of our favorite features of the program. This is when we get to showcase some of the photographs you've sent us. Jason Cole captured this nightscape from North Vancouver looking across the water. Thank you so much for that, Jason. And Harewood Longley sent in this sharp photo of a crow in flight at Crab Park. Thank you so much for that. Finally, Jacob Gerloff saw a chipmunk atop a Stawamish Chief Peak and sent us his photo of that. And please do send us more. You can email us your photographs at bcphotos@cbc.ca. All one word, bcphotos@cbc.ca. Well, getting to learn at the Royal Winnipeg Ballet School is a big opportunity. And BC's Tiernan O'Keefe wasn't going to let the pandemic stop her from realizing her dream. There's a lot of protocols to keep everyone safe, and she shared her experience with the CBC.
Hey guys, we just got out of repertoire.
Coming here is very different because we have to wear masks everywhere and we have to sanitize before we go into buildings.
Hi everyone, my name is Tiernan O'Keefe. I'm 15 years old and I'm a dancer with the Royal Winnipeg Ballet School. I just moved here this year.
In my town in BC, we didn't have to do anything. COVID didn't really exist where I'm from. It gets super hot when we're wearing masks in class. It's hard. It's hard to breathe most of the time. We take an elevator up and down residence because residence is 4 floors. We're not allowed to go on any of the other floors.
Before we eat breakfast, we have to get a health check to make sure we're healthy, so they take our temperature.
Hi.
The cooks serve us, or they have like assistants that serve us. They obviously are wearing masks. My friends and I arrived to the studio at 8, and our class starts at 8:45. But we arrived to start warming up. The bars and the floors are sanitized before we get into the studio and in between our classes. And so we pick a spot at the bar that's properly distanced from other people. It's hard to breathe most of the time, but I definitely had to experiment with different masks. I think the ones that work best for me are just regular medical masks. I have a hard time when they're giving me corrections, because normally we read people's lips, and so that's not the case.
This is my roommate, Katrina.
Hi.
Now we have school. She has pre-calculus and I have English.
All of the desks are socially distanced. We have to wear masks. We also have to sanitize our desks and chairs before and after we sit down in them. And then we also have to sanitize our hands.
Right now we are outside of the University of Winnipeg Collegiate.
The days alternate, so we only go to school with people in our cohort. We only take one class in a semester, and then we have one class online. At home, when I was online schooling, I had a lot of support from my mom. If I had any questions, I could just ask her, which I know I can still do that here, but it's different because it's also online. I wasn't worried because I know that this is definitely a super safe environment. Everything here is sanitized. There's a very low chance that anything's going to happen here because everything is so clean and so organized, I guess. If you follow the rules and just make sure that you're doing what you're supposed to be doing, then everything runs smoothly.
Coming up, scientists have been debating for years about the existence of a lost tectonic plate somewhere under Canada. Our seismologist Johanna Wagstaff explains how a new discovery puts that debate to rest.
Okay, so it's not quite like finding the lost city of Atlantis, but for geologists, well, it kind of is. Scientists have long debated the existence of an ancient tectonic plate called Resurrection that would have existed off the west coast of North America about 60 million years ago. A plate that would have given rise to the arc of volcanoes in the Pacific Ocean today. And now, two scientists from the University of Houston, including a Canadian, believe they found the missing plate sitting right underneath northern Canada.
The thing that we're really adding to the table is the first very direct evidence of the presence of the Resurrection Plate. Whereas all the thought that has been done on the Resurrection Plate previously has been based off of ancient volcanic activity and trying to relate that back to plate margins. So kind of indirect evidence, whereas we can actually look into the mantle and quantitatively find these subducted materials and bring them back up to the Earth's surface.
The team reconstructed the long-lost tectonic plate by using existing mantle tomography images, similar to a CT scan of the Earth's interior, and they modeled backwards to unfold the slabs to their historic positions. And when they did, they found that Resurrection did indeed fit into the picture. This new paper indeed supports that side of the argument.
You know, the other day, Spencer and I were talking, and he kind of described this lost plate as almost like a geological Sasquatch. You know, like people have seen footprints and, you know, signs. And here we have like the first really fuzzy image of this mythical beast.
There are actually many reasons why this finding is significant. Volcanoes form at plate boundaries, and the more plates you have, the more volcanoes you would expect there to be. And because volcanoes also affect climate change, when you're trying to model the Earth and understand how the climate has changed, you really want to know exactly how many volcanoes there have been on Earth. And now we'll have a better understanding, so stay tuned. Now you're science smart. If you have a science question on your mind, send me a tweet and I'll try to get it answered.
Thanks, Johanna, and welcome back to Our Vancouver. I'm Angela Starrett. Well, many of us have come to rely even more on the internet during the pandemic, but for some newcomers to Canada, finding access to affordable technology can be a struggle. Zara Premji explains.
Mama. Donnie.
Mama. As she turns on and logs into her donated computer, 24-year-old Shawit Burhani can't help but beam from cheek to cheek, giddy with excitement for her new connection to the outside world. After 6 months of being in BC, she received a donated computer earlier this month and feels like she can finally connect to her new home, something she's longed for.
I wasn't able to know all the things that I want to know in Vancouver. And, you know,
It was a very hard time. There is a lot of life education online on Google. All my want was blocked, you know? That's why it was very hard to me.
The mother, biology major, and immigrant from Eritrea by way of Ethiopia has waited a long time to call Canada her home. But arriving at the end of April, right as pandemic lockdowns and dependency on the virtual world ramped up, left her feeling abandoned and isolated without a computer.
As a newcomer, it's very hard to me to have a computer. And even I, you know, I didn't have any work. That's why I can buy a computer.
Berhani received a donated computer through newcomer not-for-profit Mosaic. Now she has access to bus routes, language classes, and can connect to workshops on how to write resumes and apply for jobs. Mosaic says the pandemic has put a spotlight on a growing digital divide for many vulnerable communities.
The way you apply for a job, the way you interview, the job fairs, the connections to employers are all happening online. And unless you have that, those tools and the accessibility, you cannot access those.
While they're able to access some services at the center, at home they can't. And with the pandemic, access is already so limited. Stakova says donations of computers and other devices are in desperate need. Berhani is just one of the 18,000 newcomers the center supports yearly and one of the 1,000 households in the dark without technology to connect them right now.
That device is not used by one person in that family. It's actually used by all the members of the families. Some of them apply during their language courses, some of them doing their homework, some of them applying for subsidies, some of them looking for employment.
Berhani says while this computer may seem like a common tool for most, for her and immigrants like herself, it's a lifeline to the outside world. Zara Premji, CBC News, Vancouver.
Hi, I'm Tyrone, and you're watching Our Vancouver on CBC.
Well, as we approach Vancouver's 135th anniversary, you may look to our buildings or facades for hints of our city's past, but sometimes it takes a little more digging to expose our storied past. That's what Eve Lazarus has done. The Vancouver author and journalist has combed the archives and put together a fascinating and entertaining book called Vancouver Exposed, Searching for the City's Hidden History. Hello.
Hi.
Oh, when did you realize there were so many little-known stories about our city?
Oh, it started after my first book At Home with History came out back in 2007, and it was all about Vancouver's underbelly, stories of bootleggers and madams and corruption. And once the book was finished, people kept sending me stories that added on, and, you know, they'd say, oh, my grandmother was a madam or Uncle Charlie was a bootlegger, and they'd send me photos from the family album, and I had nowhere to put them. So I ended up starting a blog called Every Place Has a Story, just really as a repository for other people's history. And it just added on and added on. And I realized last year that I had about 500 posts and photos and all sorts of stuff. And I wanted to put them somewhere else.
Wow. Well, let's dig into some of those stories. Most people probably don't realize there was a second Hotel Vancouver. What happened to it?
Well, yeah, most people don't realize there were three Hotel Vancouvers. The first one was on Georgia and Granville Street and sat there till about 1916 when they built this second absolutely fabulous Hotel Vancouver. It was 16 stories. It was the architecture was Italian Renaissance. It was ornate and elegant. And it had the exterior was sort of clad in terracotta gargoyles, and it was just this magnificent building with a rooftop and all sorts of things. And then in 1949 we pulled it down and we put up a parking lot for the next 25 years.
Wow. Do you know why it was pulled down?
Yeah, there was an arrangement with the third Hotel Vancouver. It was a CN hotel. CP owned the second Hotel Vancouver, and the Depression hit. Both were struggling, so they both went into the third. And part of the agreement was to pull down the second Hotel Vancouver rather than use it, you know, for a museum or repurpose it in some other incredible way. So it lasted for a few more years. When the Second World War veterans came back, they took it over as housing, and it lasted as housing for a couple of years and then became a parking lot.
Mm-hmm. What do we know about the, there was a steam train that crossed Hastings Street. Tell me about that.
There were many steam trains that crossed Hastings Street. We had the CPR passenger trains and freight trains, and they were coming from Waterfront Station, our current Waterfront Station, and they were going to their yards in False Creek, and they would have to cross Hastings Street to do it. So for years and decades, in fact, it just held up traffic, you know, the age-old Vancouver problem, as the steam trains crossed Hastings Street. And it went right through to 1932 when we got the Dunsmuir Tunnel, which has now been incorporated into the SkyTrain line.
And there were a number of big plans for the city that never came to be, like Project 200, a freeway through the city, as well as a waterfront development. Tell me about those two things.
Oh, thank heavens. Project 200, it's been called the, you know, most important thing that never happened to Vancouver, because if it had gone ahead, we wouldn't recognise this city, and in my opinion, not in a good way. It was called Project 200 because it would have cost $200 million, which back in 1968 would have been, you know, an incredible amount of money. And the plan was to take out all the buildings from Waterfront Station, St. Clair Centre, all the way to Woodwards on Hastings and Abbott, and put in these massive developments. And these freeways, three freeways, would come through the city and out again. And they would have taken out all of Chinatown, most of Strathcona, most of Gastown. One of them would have joined Thurlow Street, which would have gone down to Brockton Point. And there was plans to have a third crossing from Brockton Point over to North Vancouver, which just is so amazing to me. 52 years later, we still haven't got a third crossing. But I'm very happy those plans didn't go ahead. And the only thing that did happen was at the bottom of Granville, 200 Granville used to be the Sun Building, is there, and a giant parking lot. And that was the beginning of Project 200.
Wow, like a huge difference it would have made, including taking out a lot of cultural icons in our city like Chinatown. When I was reading your book, I found it really interesting, the history of the Crystal Pool. Tell me about that.
The Crystal Pool, it's now, of course, where the Aquatic Centre is now, that we all know, and, well, it's Sunset Beach. But back in 29, the plans were for this very, very swanky club called the Connaught Beach Club, and it was going to be a private club, and it was going to have tennis clubs and a Turkish bath and a roof garden and a ballroom. So, you know, a pretty big deal. And then the Depression hit. And they ran out of money. And so the only thing that they had partially finished was the pool. So the city of Vancouver took it over. And by 1939, it was operating as Crystal Pool. It was a saltwater pool. And judging by the comments that I got on my blog after I wrote the post about it, thousands and thousands of Vancouverites learned to swim there and taught or trained by Percy Norman, who was apparently a very big deal back then. And the Crystal Pool lasted until about 1974, when we replaced it with the Aquatic Centre.
It's a really incredible book. I was just having a look at it today. What are some of your favourite stories from the book?
Oh, I have to say, one of my favourite ones is the World, if I've got this right, the World Belly Flop and Cannonball Diving Competition. The picture of the hot air balloon floating across the pool is on the back of the book, and there's a full page picture in the back. But it was basically started to promote the Bayshore Hotel. They built a very, very large, fancy pool, outdoor pool, back in 1975, and Tom Butler, their PR guy, came up with this crazy, crazy scheme to promote it. And he got up, Andre the Giant came from the States and participated and actually won that year, won the prize, the World Belly Flop Prize. And it lasted for about 4 or 5 years, and it eventually moved to the Coach House Inn in North Vancouver, and that's where that photo was taken in 1979. And you've got this guy belly flopping out of the hot air balloon, breaking every safety violation you can imagine, to come in second only. And After the story came out on my blog, I got this wonderful note from Trevor Rowe, and he said, that was my dad, Bill, Kamikaze Bill, a logger from Ballingham who was participating in the belly flop competition. And Trevor said he was very, very young at the time, but he remembers his dad stuffing these weights in the T-shirt so he would weigh in at 250 pounds and be able to participate.
Such a fascinating history about our city right here. Thank you so much for sharing this with us. And for everybody, once again, the book is called Vancouver Exposed, Searching for the City's Hidden History. Eve Lazarus, thank you so much for sharing this incredible history with us today.
Thanks for having me. Thank you very much.
My name's Pooja, but you guys can call me, Ja.
A lot of big events have been canceled or gone online since the pandemic hit. The Vancouver Asian Film Festival is offering an online alternative to watching their films in a theater. One of those films is White Elephant, the first feature by Canadian filmmaker Andrew Chung, who graduated from the Vancouver Film School. With a mainly South Asian cast, it aims to turn the high school romance genre on its head. For more info, go to VAFF.org. To be in love, that's the name of the online fundraiser for the North Shore's Lodate Singers. They'll perform their favorite musical theater solos and duets celebrating love. A $40 donation gets you access. For more info, go to Lodate, that's L-A-U-D-A-T-E, singers.com.
Hey, I'm Grant Lawrence from CBC Music, here to let you know that we have reached another milestone in this year's Canadian Music Class Challenge. That's when we challenge music teachers across the country to teach your kids a Canadian song and make a video like this. Yeah, that's the Calgary Arts Academy with their spirited entry from last year called Nowhere With You, an indie anthem by Joel Plaskett. Now, obviously, because of the restrictions put in place by COVID-19, we are fully aware that the 2020 version of the Canadian Music Class Challenge will look very different this year, probably a lot more like this. That is the Waterloo Collegiate Institute with their Zoom video performance of the piece One Last Time. And that's how a lot of the entries for this year's Canadian Music Class Challenge are going to look. And you know what? We can't wait. We have instructional videos up at cbc.ca/musicclass in case you need to figure out how to make one of those. And this year, classes can choose from 22 different songs, including these. Walking down Yonge Street on a Friday. Can't follow them, gotta do it my way. No fast lane, still on the highway. Moving in and out, no doubt there's a bright day. No time to get down, cause I'm moving up. No time to get down, cause I'm moving up. No time to get down, cause I'm moving up. Shake off the grass in the bucket. I'm gonna miss it when it's over. Yeah, yeah. I hope we never see October. Yeah, yeah. I felt the weight fall off my shoulders. Yeah, that's the Sam Roberts Band from Montreal with a song that has become somewhat of an anthemic rallying cry this year. We're all in this together. That song and 21 others can be chosen by music teachers and classes now if you want to participate in our 2020 Canadian Music Class Challenge. And hey, the video submissions period is open now. You have until November to get your videos in to compete for thousands of dollars in prizes. And hey, if your school isn't allowing music this year, check out our risk-free, lesson plan-based Canadian Playlist Challenge. Find out everything you need to know at cbc.ca/musicclass. I'm Grant Lawrence. Keep Canadian music education alive, and I'll check in with you again soon.
Coming up, an Abbotsford teen shows us how she tries to juggle learning in person and online. Welcome back to Our Vancouver. I'm Angela Sterrett. If you want to see what life is like for young people during the COVID-19 pandemic, just ask them to record it on their phones. Here's how Abbotsford Mia Gill splits her time between learning in person and online.
Okay, before we get into class every day, each of us have to put on our mask. So let's get this on.
You have a great day.
Going to school is really bizarre because it's not like the typical day where I get to go to all my classes and see all my friends. I am Mia Gill. I live in Abbotsford, BC, and I am currently going to high school during the pandemic.
So every single day when we come in, we have to get hand sanitizer and wear your mask through the doors.
Thank you. Bye.
COVID-19 is a pretty big concern. I have having family around me. I am concerned about their safety as well.
When we are walking through the hallways, we need to keep a mask on and everybody needs to stay to the right the whole time. Good job, Summer.
Everybody needs to scan this code to get the daily health assessment. That's a little survey on Google Forms.
This year we're doing a quarterly system. This way students are less exposed to other people.
In this quarter, we have two classes. For 5 weeks, you go to one class in person and you do the other class online. So my schedule looks way, way, way different than the last 2 years of high school.
We have made it to foods class, as you can see, with the kitchen. Since this is like my learning cohort, this is the class that I'm in every day. It's safe for me to take off my mask because this class is kind of like my social bubble.
We are making California rolls.
For me, I didn't really know that many people in my class going into it.
So everybody here is a part of my lab group. We make a pretty good team here, and it's like another way that we just don't interact with every other student in the room.
I think for some it might be really difficult to be making friends around this time, especially if it's just one class per day.
Now we're on my walk home.
So I just got home, which means I've changed and I've washed my hands, and it's time for lunch, so I've made some vegan mac and cheese. So this is my desk setup. This is actually my mom's work desk. And then I get started on the second half of my day, which is my online school from home. So I'll be doing math here now.
Before my very stressful math test, my friend and I got the chance to study together.
So Jewel and I here have made it outside into this nice place.
We aren't in the same learning cohort. So that being said, just for our safety, we decided to wear masks together.
We have like an hour before our test and then we'll go inside.
I think that going to school in person or going to school online, they both have really stressful factors. For some, it might be the self-isolation and handling a whole class by yourself without peers, or handling school in person with the stress of not having any friends in your class for 3 hours.
Right now, I'm on an evening walk with my parents. I used to be a really competitive swimmer and a swim coach.
But since it's really unsafe to be kind of around those areas right now, I've been doing a lot of walking and just trying to get outside.
Hi. Good morning, Mia. Have a great day.
Thank you.
At school and online, I've gotten to talk to a lot of kids, and we are kind of concerned to be doing one class in 10 weeks or to be doing one class for 3 hours. One thing that the pandemic's taught me is that I really cannot expect or predict what's going to happen in the future.
Our first class is done. We just need to come back later on.
I just kind of learned to roll with the punches a lot more this year.
Good morning, everybody. I have a very special announcement to make today. It's my birthday. Yep. Guess who just turned 16 in the pandemic? Me.
Me. We just need to remind ourselves to take it easy and, you know, take a step back, because even the thought of going to school in a pandemic is pretty crazy.
The CBC documentary series Absolutely Canadian is back with two documentaries. This weekend, Moonless Oasis takes you deep below the house sound to glass sponge reefs long thought to be extinct. Check out this trailer.
We're about to do something that's going to be fairly complex, fairly serious. Some things go wrong, we need safe divers in the water within minutes. You guys' heads got to be in the game, right?
Sponge reefs were once found throughout the world's oceans. Now we're left with a remnant.
None of us knew that there were glass sponge reefs in Howe Sound.
Things go very wrong the deeper you go. And that's where fatalities can happen.
As citizen scientists, we should be exploring to try to help bring awareness to these animals.
These animals exist, and they need that level of protection.
This is something special, and it's in our own backyard. Every single reef, we see signs of damage. Putting words on paper and putting lines on a map only does so much.
It's really valuable when members of the community want to contribute to science. There's an estimated 90% of species we have yet to even discover in the oceans. There's so many unknowns still.
If we don't actually document these sites, we can't protect them. I mean, they're just screaming for protection. If this was a coral reef out there, there would have been no hesitation about closing it. They may disappear before we learn much more about them.
You can watch Moonless Oasis on CBC Gem. Coming up, find out how growing giant pumpkins isn't just fun, it's serious business. Welcome back to Our Vancouver. I'm Angela Sterrett. Well, carved pumpkins are all around us at Halloween. You can buy one at most grocery stores or even a pumpkin patch. But there's a man in North Vancouver who grows his own. But as Deborah Goble explains, these are not your average gourds.
We peek over the back gate and we see everything secretly covered.
Every year at this time it happens.
We just see just kind of shapes of things getting bigger and bigger. Oh, Jeff's at it again.
Jeff Peltier, also affectionately known by another name in this North Vancouver neighborhood.
We say the pumpkin guy.
Because for 6 years now he's been growing them in his backyard. But his are not your everyday Halloween pumpkins.
So has this been splitting naturally?
That's a pumpkin.
Just because of
the pumpkin.
You want to go see it?
It's very big.
Size and girth are what matters in the competitive pumpkin world.
In this case, yes. The bigger, the better.
It's pretty cool. I'd like to try to grow one, actually.
But you better know, pumpkin people take this hobby very seriously.
There's a site, actually, and I think it's called pumpkinfanatics.com, but it contains the genetic lineage of every pumpkin that's been entered in competition. So this one's after my grandmother. It's named Muriel.
Muriel weighs in at 923 pounds, not as hefty as some of Jeff's previous contenders.
When you come up off the ground.
This was Grop, named after the giant in Harry Potter. At 1,167 pounds, Grop came in second at the 2017 BC Pumpkin Growing Competition. Still, Muriel's no slouch. She's solid.
Whoa, that is strong.
How do you even weigh that? Wouldn't that, like, break the scale or something?
This year, because of COVID, there's no pumpkin competition.
So we thought, let's just do it in the front yard, and it's been great for the neighborhood. You know, they actually get to come and see them.
Did he roll it out here, or is this where he grew it?
Well, I heard you need a crane to move it.
She heard right. Even going from backyard to front takes some maneuvering.
That's kind of our goal this year, is to try and get other growers interested in the hobby.
And if you've got the knack, there's cash to be made. When a pumpkin grower in Belgium grew a record-breaking 2,600-pounder, he didn't just win prize money.
He'd pulled about 1,000 seeds out of the pumpkin and was charging $700 each and sold out of seeds.
Like raising racehorses, growing big gourds can be lucrative.
$50 a seed, $100 a seed for a really top seed, that's pretty normal.
600 square feet of good dirt? That's all you need to get started, says Jeff.
I often say to people, I've never seen someone go buy a giant pumpkin without smiling.
Can you make a scary face?
Deborah Goble, CBC News, North Vancouver.
With COVID-19, there's a lot more interest in getting the flu shot this year. In 2004, Canadians saw Americans flocking north to get vaccinated too. Chris Brown had that story.
Americans are climbing on board the Flu Cruise, otherwise known as the Victoria Clipper Catamaran. Its operators have put on extra trips to bring as many as 1,000 people to get their Canadian flu shots.
I couldn't get a flu shot in San Diego, but I was on vacation in Seattle, and we heard that they were giving them in Canada, so we signed up.
It is a cross-border shopping story the U.S. news media can't seem to get enough of. Nor can the private clinics in Canadian border towns, now doing a brisk business selling those shots for up to $50 a needle.
For most of these people, it is life and death. They have chronic problems, COPD, asthma, diabetics who really should be having the flu shot, and they shouldn't have to wait till January.
January is when the U.S. supply of flu vaccine should return to normal. In the meantime, there's been something of a ripple effect here in Canada.
More news means more awareness, which usually translates into more flu shots.
For me, it's just like throwing a dart, okay?
Okay, go.
On Parliament Hill, they had the needles out, along with some reassurances that there is still plenty of vaccine for Canadians.
We purchase in bulk for what we think will be the optimal number of doses for Canada.
In stock, but not always available exactly when people want it. In some spots, the unexpected American demand has created supply bottlenecks.
People's anxiety level is definitely heightened. They're seeing Americans coming up and paying for the vaccine, and then they're phoning their family doctor and they're unable to make an appointment to get their flu shot until a little bit later than they normally would.
The company that makes most of Canada's flu vaccine says it has distributed an additional 500,000 doses to accommodate the extra demand. Still, interest from the U.S. remains strong. Earlier this week, there was even a listing on the internet site eBay selling 20 doses of the Canadian vaccine for up to $200 a shot. Chris Brown, CBC News, Vancouver.
Ben Nelms is CBC Vancouver's award-winning staff photographer. Here are some samples of the best images he shared with us this week. That's all for Our Vancouver this week. Bye for now.
Andrew, I'm gonna come over here.